Good morning. It's wonderful to see everybody in their red today. That was my mother's favorite color. Welcome to Northport Community United Church of Christ, where no matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, you are always welcome here. Thank you to everyone for wearing your masks, and remember it is important for you to leave your mask on during the entire service. It needs to cover your mouth and nose, and is especially important to not remove it when singing. Your cooperation is important. As you are dismissed by row at the end of the service, please remember to keep your 6-foot distancing, and please look up at the camera above the doorway and wave to our friends who are watching online. Please keep the line moving all the way out to the parking lot. Thanks. If you have not received your COVID vaccine, CVS in Northport is offering them. Walk-ins are welcome. Just stop by. Pastor Attila will be away for one more week. He will return next Sunday. Should you have a pastoral care emergency while he is away, please contact the church office. Bug. Once again, we welcome Pastor Dave Powell, who is leading us in our worship service today. Thank you for being with us. The flowers today are given by Larry Swanson in honor of Donna's 70th birthday next Saturday. The Monday morning Zoom coffee hour will be at 10 a.m. tomorrow. Please email the church office to be included. Tuesday Bible study is at 11 a.m. outside. Bring your chair and your lunch. There will be no prayer line this week. Prayer Zoom will be on Thursday this week at 10 a.m. Please email the church office to be included. As we look toward the fall, it is hoped to have the choir begin rehearsing in August with the target goal of being able to sing in October. Kim is looking for new and returning choir members. Please let Kim know if you are interested. Reminder, if you have a cell phone, we ask that you please turn it off or turn it on silent. Let us be in worship.
Good morning. I think that we should thank Dr. Wolf for that beautiful prelude that stirred our hearts and souls again. Dr. Wolf, thank you. Brent Campus had to be out today, and when Kim called and told me that he wasn't going to make it last night, I happened to have a friend, Martine Muir, staying with us, And I said, Martine, are you willing? And he said something about breakfast. And I said, if you're willing to read. Would you welcome my friend Martine Muir as he leads us through the liturgy this morning. So now as we come to the call to worship, as you're able, let us stand.
Good morning. If you'll join with me in the responses to our call to worship. As Jesus began his earthly ministry, he said, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor." May we bring good news to the poor as ministers of Christ Jesus.
Come on, worship the Lord.
Create in us clean hearts, O God, and put new and right spirits within us.
Do not cast us away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from us.
Restore to us the joy of your salvation.
And sustain us with your Spirit.
Let us worship God. If you will please join with me in our prayer of confession. Spirit of truth, you know all too well what lurks deep within us. We have not faithfully used the powerful gifts of love and service you gave to the church. We are quick to find fault and spread gossip. We undermine the fellowship of believers. We have left strangers and seekers among us feeling like outsiders. We have not done our best to carry the good news of Jesus Christ beyond these walls. Renew a spirit within us that we may carry Christ's love and mercy from this place to our community and to the world beyond. We pray in the name of Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Father, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please hear these words of assurance of pardon. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves, so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we may also share in his glory. Amen.
Start with the birthdays this morning. Jill Kelly is having a birthday on Thursday. Saturday, Donna Swanson is having her birthday. I think we heard about that a few moments ago. And then for any birthdays that were not on our list. Okay. Anniversaries Tuesday, Jean and Mary Maples are celebrating. Are they here this morning? There you are. Congratulations. And then Alden and Sharon Miller are also having an anniversary this week. They're online. Okay. Hi. Okay. Any other anniversaries that we have missed? Okay. Kim, would you lead us in singing? For our prayer concerns, Dolores Edwards managed to break her arm last week. And how you doing? Well, I'm glad you're here, and our prayer is that you start doing better. Okay. Doris Bush is undergoing some health procedures. Pat Ahrens will be having surgery this week, so please keep her in your prayers. And we'll continue in prayers for Alida Carpenter. She is home. I didn't see her a while ago. There, she's okay. Oh, back there. Okay. Hi, Alida. Glad you're doing better. Lola Van Wert, we want to keep her in our prayers. Doris Olvenick, is that close enough? Tom Phillips, Mina Sundin, and Maureen Frederick and her daughter, Laura, they continue to go through. Any other prayer concerns we need to lift up this morning? Okay, I like when Pastor asks, do you have an unvoiced prayer concern? Just raise your hand and we'll just know that you've got some things on your heart and soul. Okay, very good. Let us come to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, we gather today in anticipation. For you have told us that whenever two or more are gathered in your name, you will be present. And as you are present, we know that your Holy Spirit is among us. We know that there is power. We know that there is healing. We know that there is joy. So we know that there is a sweet, sweet spirit in this room. And we know that you hear us. That is an amazing promise that the Creator of the universe promises to be with us, to hear us, and to answer our prayers. So Lord, this day, we lift up to you the concerns of our heart. We lift up to you our confession. Confession of those things which we have said, done, and felt that separate us from you. A confession of those things which we have left undone, that we have felt your call to be a part to answer in prayer. So, Lord, we lift up to you the birthdays, the anniversaries, but also the concerns. You, Dolores and Doris and Pat, touch their hearts today. We pray that you continue to be with Elida and Lola and Doris and Tom and Mina and Maureen and Laura as they journey through these times of healing and resolution. We pray with all those who have unspoken needs. But also, Lord, we lift up our country, for we are a troubled nation. We pray that you would let your spirit guide us to find a resolution to the problems that we are facing. And we pray that as we talk to each other, that first we would listen. Try to understand the hearts, the calling, the hopes, the fears, and the dreams of each other. And that as a nation, we would learn how to join hands and work together for all persons. While the peace now in the Middle East is tenuous, we also celebrate it and pray that you continue to be with our brothers and sisters there as they try and find a way to live in peace. That part of the world, Lord, as you know, has been in conflict for millennia. And even though your son tells us that there will be wars and rumors and wars until the end, we still pray for peace, for that is the need and the desire. Lord, we give you thanks for those who serve our community, fire, EMS, enforcement, those who serve in the medical communities. Continue to be with them, for while so much of our society seems to think that the pandemic is completely behind us, there are still illnesses and still deaths. We still need to care for each other. So help us, Lord, to continue to be considerate, to continue to protect each other. Lord, there are so many things on our heart, and you hear those prayers, you hear those needs. Help us, Lord, to be a part of your answer to the prayers of the many. For we pray it in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen and amen. Oops. Because of the pandemic, we have not had an official time of offering for a long time. And just recently, Pastor has been reminding you that the offering box is in the back and encouraging you to worship through your tithes and offerings there. But as we talk about the Holy Spirit today, I want to remind you, because I think most of you know this, that our call to service, our call to sacrifice, our call to generosity is more than our tithes and offerings on Sunday morning. There's a part of the Methodist liturgy that talks about time, talents, gifts, and presence. Our relationship with Christ is not just a Sunday morning thing. It is a way of life. And so as Kim sings our first special this morning, I invite you to listen to her words, but also listen to how the Spirit is talking to you about a spirit of generosity and what that might mean in your life as you journey with Christ in a spirit of generosity. So be in prayer, be led by the music, and let Christ touch your heart. Almighty God, if we were to take 10 minutes and list all the blessings, all of your gifts, beginning with the gift of life and creation, going to the gift of just being able to gather to worship, the 10 minutes would not nearly be long enough. For you truly have blessed us. You have blessed us with your Holy Spirit. And you have given us a heart of generosity to serve you and proclaim you in all that we do. So now, Lord, let us give thanks. Let us give praise. For it is your Spirit and your life and your salvation that we rejoice in. Amen and amen. As you're able, let's stand and join together in the doxology. Please be seated.
Hear now these words from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. The Holy Spirit comes at Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost came, They were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now, there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they ask one another, "What does this mean?" May the Lord add his blessing to the speaking and hearing of these words.
Thank you, Martine. Appreciate you picking that up at the last minute. That list of countries would have been a challenge for some folks. Might not have made friends. Will you pray for me as I pray for us? Lord, we have heard your word proclaimed in the book of Acts about your mighty, mighty gift of the Holy Spirit, a gift that was not new, but did change in the way that it interacted with the church, with the way you interacted with the church. So today, as we look to your Holy Spirit and our journey with you, we ask your blessing. And we ask now that you would bless the meditations of this heart and the words of these lips, and bless this humble witness for Christ's sake. Amen. Got a couple questions as we get started this morning. First off, would you raise your hand if you completely understand the Holy Spirit? Okay, because I was going to ask you to come up here and help me out if you did. Of all the mysteries of God, there seem to be more mysteries around the Holy Spirit than others. And sometimes I find among Protestants, there's a lot of fear about the Holy Spirit, a fear that we'll be embarrassed, fear that we won't be in control, fear just because we don't understand. So we're going to talk about not being embarrassed on Pentecost. Today is Pentecost. It is a holiday. How many of you went out and got Pentecost cards and mailed them to all your friends this week? Nobody raised their hand. Not even me. But it is a holiday. Now, there are lots of holidays anymore. In fact, if you look on the internet, you can find a list of all the national days. And every day is the national day of at least four or five things. It's crazy. There's National Lizard Day. Then there are good ones. There's like the National Donut Day, which Dunkin' Donuts is an important part of that. So Kim was celebrating that, continuing to celebrate that in spirit and heart as she carried her Dunkin' Donuts in and didn't bring enough for the class. We'll talk about that later. But what's your favorite holiday? Of all the holidays that you have, and this is a real question, not rhetorical. We're not going to poll the whole group of you, but just a couple that are quick in your thinking. which I suspect you are. What is your favorite holiday? You're going to have to say that good and loud because I'm not repeating it.
St. Swithin's Day.
Is that from Harry Potter?
No.
No? Oh, okay. You can tell me more about that after worship. St. Swithin's Day. Okay. A good Irish day. What's another one?
Thanksgiving.
Ah, wonderful day. Mm-hmm. Christmas. Oh, someone said Christmas? Okay.
Easter.
Easter. Great. Anybody list their birthday?
Grandchildren's
birthdays, oh, those are special, yeah. We have lots of special days. As a church, we remember the birth of Christ, one of our very important days, which our grandchildren very often enjoy as well. And Good Friday is another very important day. In my opinion, probably the most forgotten of the holy days of the church, because that was the day that Christ died for our sins. So many of us go from Palm Sunday and the parade and the joy of that day straight to Easter and the joy of resurrection, forgetting how important the death of Christ is in that mix. So Good Friday. And then, of course, Easter. But there are also a lot of days that touch our hearts, our lives, our nation in special ways. And for some reason, when I was growing up, and I was a military brat, so my experience was a lot different than a lot of other normal people. But a day that I heard a lot about as I grew up was this one.
Vice President, Mr. Speaker, members of the Senate, of the House of Representatives, yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
A day that lived in infamy. A day that now is very far and a lot of folks don't remember real well. But I heard about it a lot growing up. The fact that I went to first, second, third, and fourth grade in Japan may have influenced that as well. Went there just 15 years after Hiroshima and Nagasaki, which was a day that lived in infamy in Japan. There are lots of days that have shaped us as individuals, as community, as nations, but also as Christians. And some of them we recognize more than others. Some of them have faded into the past, kind of like December 7th has for so much of our nation. And one of them is Shavuot, Pentecost. Well, today is Pentecost, and we're going to talk about it. And it wasn't a new holiday to the Jews. This was a day that came 50 days after the second day of Passover. And it was celebrated by the Jews as a major holiday at that point. They had Passover, and Shavuot was one of the next most important holidays. The crowd stayed that 50 days. Can you imagine how happy the vendors, the hotel people, everybody was that all these folks would hang around for another 50 days? Hotel folks probably loved it. there was still a crowd on what we call Pentecost. It was the Jewish Pentecost was a time when they would join the church, there would, the converts would be baptized. But it was also, it started out as a festival of harvest. The first harvest would be collected in Jerusalem at that point, or in Israel, excuse me. But it became a celebration of Moses receiving the Ten Commandments. Not something we celebrate a whole lot anymore. You probably didn't mail cards to each other about that either. But a celebration of God and God's covenant with the people of Israel. God saying to the people of Israel who had come out as slaves from Egypt, I will be your God and you will be my people, and here's what I expect. This is how to be in relationship to each other. If you want me as your God, don't have any other gods before me. I get jealous about things like that. If you want to be the people of God, don't lie to each other. It's bad for relationships. Don't kill each other. Killing each other is really bad for relationships. And you know the rest of the Ten Commandments. It's how to be a people. This was a covenant that God made with the people. A covenant he continues to make through the Holy Spirit with you and I. And sometimes I wonder how we're doing keeping that covenant. Even those relatively simple 10 things. For a lot of the Jews, this was considered the birthday of their faith, a very important holiday. And covenants, the Old Testament is full of them. Covenants with God and God's people, what the expectations are. Expectations are important. Part of the work I did with couples as a pastor was helping them understand the expectations that they have with each other. And when those got out of balance, the marriage was out of balance. There's one in Jeremiah, we see part of that covenant and part of that expectation. In Jeremiah 31, as they are gathered to receive the Ten Commandments, it says, "The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, even though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law," listen to this close, "I will put my law in their minds, and I will write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, 'Know the Lord,' because they will all know me. From the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord, for I will forgive them their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts." Did mom, did grandma ever say to you, "You know right from wrong. Why do you keep doing it wrong?" The law is written on our hearts as if with tongues of fire, it seems. And that's what Pentecost is about. As Martine read for us, when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. The town was still crowded. When suddenly the sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting, and they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit was not a new thing. The Spirit of God had been with the people from the very beginning. Holy Spirit was part of creation, just as the gospel writer of John reminds us that Jesus was there at the beginning, the Word, But the Holy Spirit, that part of the Trinity, has always been there. But at this point, its job description changed a little bit, and it was a lot more present with the people. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in tongues as the Spirit enabled them. And there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. And when they heard the sound, the crowd came together in bewilderment because each of them heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these speaking Galileans?" Which, by the way, Galileans were kind of the folks from the other side of the tracks, according to the rest of the Jews. Not as bad as the Samaritans, mind you, but not a whole lot. Not a whole lot better. So then how is it that we each hear them in our native language? And then we get the list of where everybody is from. And that list is important. Martine thought I put it in there just to harass him. Maybe that's why Brent isn't here today. He didn't want to read those names. But it's important because the Jews were not an evangelistic people. Have you ever had the Jews come and knock on your door and say, "I'd like to share the ride of the Pentateuch with you"? Mm-mm. They don't. It's not evangelism. You can, as a Gentile, become a Jew, but you are a converted Jew. And for Jesus to tell them and remind them again and again, and as you read the letters of Paul, you realize what a struggle it was for them to accept the fact that is the God of all people. All people. It was amazing to them that God would, all these people, all these nations were the people of God. And they understood it here, but it had a hard time getting here. And from the way that the people of Israel behave today, it still seems to be a tough message. Now, the other part of that is the rest of the world doesn't treat them too well either. But the power of God, the love of God, the salvation of God is for all people. That covenant is something that God calls us to live yet today. In 2 Corinthians, Paul says, "You show that you are a letter from Christ, a message, the result of your ministry, not written with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, the Holy Spirit, not on tablets on stone, but on tablets of human heart." In seminary, in our intro to ministry class, this was over coming up on 45 years ago that I was there, that doesn't impress some of you, I know. But one of the things they told us, reminded us, was that you can teach whatever you want to teach, and some folks will remember some of it. You can preach whatever you want to preach, and some folks will remember some of it. What they will remember is how you made them feel, what you touched their heart with. That's what they will remember at the end of the day. Not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of human hearts. What is your heart feeling today? What is your heart feeling on Pentecost, the birthday of the church, when the Holy Spirit came in a new and powerful way? What is happening to your heart today? Picking up after Martine finished reading, Luke writes, "Some, however, made fun of them." They're on top of the house talking in tongues, and everybody understands them. Some people said they've had too much wine. Have you ever noticed that some folks, when they see something happening that they don't understand, that maybe they're a little afraid of, start discounting it? Those people are crazy. Those people are zealots. Those people are drunk. They're on drugs. They're Jesus freaks. They discount it and push it aside. Maybe they've had too much wine. This couldn't be the power of God, even though we're here on Pentecost to celebrate God acting among our people. And granted, at that point, it was around 600 years earlier. Long memories, good memories, that God had given them the Ten Commandments. Even though they had shown up to celebrate God, they didn't expect God to be present. Did you expect God to be present on Pentecost Sunday? For God to touch your heart? Do you expect it? I always liked the story, and preachers like lots of strange stories, but one of my favorites was the congregation gathered during a drought to pray for rain. And the pastor got up and he said, "How many of you brought an umbrella?" And one little boy held his umbrella up. He came to pray for rain and expected something to happen. When you come, especially on Pentecost Sunday, expecting the Holy Spirit to touch you in worship, do you expect something to happen? Or do you come to listen to the beautiful music, and it is gorgeous? Kim, Dr. Wolf, it's gorgeous. And it leads us in worship. But do you expect God to do something in your heart? Do you expect to go home different? Maybe not a world different, maybe just a little bit different, but to grow in Christ in some way with the Holy Spirit, because that's what Pentecost Sunday is about, is reminding us that the Holy Spirit is present every day and that God calls us to continue growing, changing our hearts, our lives, and the rest of the world. So Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. "Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain to you. Listen carefully to what I'm about to say. These people are not drunk. It's only 9 in the morning." I'm not sure that's a real good excuse. As we're reminded from our friend down a little bit further south, it's 5 o'clock somewhere. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. And Joel said, "In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show them wonders in heaven above and signs on earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the world of the Lord." You've been watching the news? December 7th, lots of blood and smoke, pillars of fire. It continues. Israel was full of blood and smoke and pillars of fire this last week. Some of our own cities were that way. It's still coming. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Are you calling? Do you call upon the name of the Lord? Then the people heard this. They were cut to the heart. So they were listening. Isn't that amazing? They were listening. And Peter and the other apostles, and they said to them, "Brothers, what shall we do?" They were a little befuddled. "What do we do?" And Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. Repent and be baptized." And with this and many other words, he was a preacher, so there were many other words, he warned them and he pleaded with them. He said, "Save yourselves from this corrupt generation." Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. That's a lot of folk. He did not have a soft baritone voice like mine that goes out 3 feet and drops down. 3,000 people, more than 3,000, were able to hear. And the Holy Spirit helped them understand, and their lives and their heart and their eternity were changed that day. What do we do? We save, accept salvation, and become not part of the corrupt generation. 2,000 years ago, and that's still the message today. Save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Be of Christ, don't be of the world. So what was the miracle of that day, of Pentecost? Was it the wind? That was pretty amazing. People, it drove people over there. They were wondering what was going on. That was a miracle, but not the miracle of the day. Was it the fire, the tongues of fire above their head? That'd be pretty cool. All of us pray and all of a sudden Martine's head catches on fire. That would get your attention, wouldn't it? That was a miracle, but not the miracle of the day. Was it the speaking in tongues? Some say it was temporary. Some say it still happens. But the Spirit still moves, and I think it's still a valid gift for today. But that was not the miracle of the day. Was it that Peter, who had denied Jesus 3 times, now made such a powerful sermon and presentation on love and power and the power of the Holy Spirit? Again, that was not the miracle of the day. Was it that the rest of Jesus' disciples were not arrested? That was kind of weird, but it still was not the miracle of the day. Was it that these simple fishermen in Galilee and looked on down on so many started changing the whole world that day? Still, a miracle, but not the miracle of the day. The real miracle is in verse 41, people being saved. Those who accepted this miracle, this message, were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to that number that day, and that kept happening. Because that is the lasting miracle. That is the eternal miracle. It's not that you get to church on a particular Sunday. It's not that you wear your red shirt. It's that your heart is changed and given to Jesus Christ. That is the miracle. As your sins are forgiven, and you come to eternity with God, that is the miracle of the day. That is the miracle of eternity. That's pretty cool. So we don't need another Pentecost, because the Holy Spirit never left. We need to realize that Pentecost has happened and is happening. The Spirit still moves among us. And to go and be led by the Spirit that leads us in lives as believers. And to not be afraid. I know some people are afraid that the Spirit will take over and they'll do something embarrassing, like roll down the aisle or something. The Spirit promises not to embarrass you. Some people are afraid they'll get possessed like something out of one of Stephen King's movies or something. And that's not the way the Spirit works either. As you give your life to Christ and you open your heart to the Holy Spirit, it guides you. It shows you opportunities to be in service. It empowers you, but it's not going to embarrass you. Some of the doors that will be opened by the Spirit in both your heart and in your service will challenge you. If we had another 20 minutes, we'd just follow that rabbit. Because sometimes God's work is challenging and scary. But the Holy Spirit doesn't force us. It calls us. It walks with us. It fills us. But it doesn't force us. And we are invited to put the power of God to test in our lives with the Holy Spirit. To take on something so big that it can only be successful because the power and the Spirit of God are with us. We are called to be witnesses. In whatever way is possible. So Pentecost may be a day on the church calendar. It may be a holiday. But really what Pentecost is for us today, it's a way of life. It's a relationship with Jesus Christ. And it bears fruit. So the marks of a Christian or the fruits of a Christian is that you give all you are and all you can be to Christ. That's not just time, talent, gifts, and presents. This is not a stewardship sermon. It's where is your heart? Where is your enthusiasm? Where is your dream? And do you live it out? Where is your time? Where is your talent? If God gave you a talent of singing, are you using it to serve God, to proclaim God's love? Kim leads us in that beautiful worship. If I sang, you'd probably all leave the building, and who would blame you? But what are you doing with your gifts and your talents? How are you glorifying God, letting the Spirit lead you? And are you welcoming God's presence? Not holding God off at an arm's length, but in a daily, intimate relationship. That's what the Holy Spirit is about, is that daily, intimate relationship. It's not a season. It is a way of life. In a few minutes, when we do end the service, we have a song and then we'll end the service, so it's almost over. There'll be a covenant prayer. John Wesley put together this real long covenant service. I made it a very short prayer for us, and we're going to close with that. And when you leave, Patty and her lovely assistants are going to hand you that covenant prayer on a small piece of paper. I think we're still doing that, aren't we, Patty? Good. I want you to take that home. Put it on your mirror. Put it someplace where you'll see it every day. Be reminded of the covenant that God calls you to with the power of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Lord, you call us not to sit in church, but to be the church. You call us to be the people of God. You call us to be yours. And to that end, you give us the Holy Spirit to help make that happen. You give us forgiveness, and you give us victory. So, Lord, today, you who love us so much that you sent your Son to live among us, to teach among us, and to die for us, and to raise him from the dead, leading us into eternity. You who love us so much, call us to live with you each and every day, without embarrassment, without coercion, but with victory and joy and with love. So guide us now and let us embrace you for Christ's sake. Amen and amen. As you're able, let us stand. Let us therefore go to Christ and pray. Let me be your servant under your command. I will no longer be my own. I will give myself to your will in all things. Be satisfied that Christ shall give you your place and work. Lord, make me what you will. Put myself fully into your hands. Bring me to doing, put me to suffering. Let me be employed for you or laid aside for you. Let me be full, let me be empty. Let me have all things, let me have nothing. I freely and with a willing heart give all to your pleasure and disposal. Amen and amen.